So let's begin our presentation by first talking about dietary fiber, get us all on a common footing when it comes to what dietary fiber is all about. I'm going to show you two definitions. Don't necessarily need to read them to you, but you can see them on the screen there. This is the American Association of Cereal Chemists definition that talks about what constitutes dietary fiber. And you can see some key elements of the carbohydrates resistant to digestion, resistant to absorption in the small intestine with complete or partial fermentation in the large intestine. One of the key elements of dietary fiber is its beneficial physiological benefit. So a health benefit is involved in that. So it shows you a little bit of the components that are considered dietary fiber according to the definition by AACC. The Codex definition gets a little bit more detailed and captures some of the elements that aren't necessarily captured in the AACC definition. For instance, if you look near the bottom, it talks about the synthetic carbohydrate polymers, RS3s, RS4s, RS4s being the synthetics, but it means to capture some more of the constituents, if you will, of dietary fiber. But common to both is this idea of a physiological effect or a health benefit that can be demonstrated by scientific evidence, by competent authorities. In a picture form, this is a chart provided by Barry McCleary that gives you an idea of what is captured by the different methods. And this is a good time to just mention that the methods have similarities in the enzymes and things used for the analysis, but there are time differences, there are temperature differences in the methods. The ultimate goal is to try to replicate human digestion when we're looking at dietary fiber analysis. On the left-hand side, you see AOAC 98529 and 991.43. These are methods that take about 3 to 4 hours in process. We're going to talk a little bit more in detail about those in the future. But you can see there's a number of components that are either not captured or only partially captured in those two methods. When you go to the Codex definition on the right-hand side, as you recall, there is a little bit more detail in what constitutes dietary fiber under the Codex definition. For instance, it captures all of the resistant starch, not just RS2 or 1 and 2. It captured all the fructans, all the NDOs, things like that. So the difference, of course, one of the differences, I should say, in these Codex definition methods, in this case 2009-01, is that rather than a 3 or 4 hour process, the Codex definition is more like a 18 hour process, 16 hours just for its initial digestion. So a lot more time involved in that to capture all those components. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we continue on. But that's just a background for us. What we're going to do for this presentation is we're going to start with a recorded message from Barry McCleary updating some of his work on a rapid integrated dietary fiber method. Well, this is a work that Barry has been doing to shorten the time of some of the Codex definitions while still perhaps better representing the resistant starch fractions that just are problematic in a number of the methods. So we're going to do that as a recording. Barry could not be with us right now. He is going to try to join us remotely, but for now we have his recorded message. So we're going to start with that. And then Brian Layton and I are going to talk about the dietary fiber automation. When you look at such a time-consuming laborious method, automation is critical to helping precision, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. But let's first start with Barry McCleary's presentation, so let us load that up, and we'll play that through.
Hello, I'm Barry McCleary, CEO and owner of Megazyme International. In this presentation, I'd like to talk to you about advances in the measurement of total dietary fiber, and more specifically, the development of a rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure. In this slide, we see the definition and measurement of dietary fiber, the definition developed by Trowell in 1976, which is primarily a physiological definition based on edibility and resistance to digestion in the human small intestine. The definition includes indigestible polysaccharides such as gums, modified celluloses, mucilages, and pectins, and non-digestible oligosaccharides. The method developed to measure dietary fiber according to trial's definition was the Prosky method, in which thermostable alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase were used to hydrolyze the starch to glucose, protease to hydrolyze the protein to peptides, and then alcohol precipitation to remove the low molecular weight hydrolyzed material from the high molecular weight fiber. And this was recovered, dried, and weighed. However, it's known that in this method, protein is not completely hydrolyzed, so residual protein in the residue is measured and subtracted, as also as ash. But also known in some, for some samples, that starch is also not completely hydrolyzed, leading to the concept of resistant starch. This procedure is outlined in this slide, where the aim was simply to remove protein and starch so that the residue could be measured gravimetrically and ash and residual protein subtracted to give dietary fiber values. In 2008, the Codex Alimentarius introduced a new definition of dietary fiber, which includes resistant starch and an option to include non-digestible oligosaccharides, this decision to be left to national authorities. A method developed to service this definition was that published by myself in 2007 and employs pancreatic alpha amylase plus amyloglucosidase at 37 degrees for 16 hours to hydrolyze non-resistant starch to glucose, protease at 60 degrees centigrade to hydrolyze protein to peptides, and alcohol precipitation again to separate the high molecular weight material from the hydrolyzed fragments. This method was successfully evaluated in AOAC and AACC interlaboratory evaluation to become AOAC method 2009.01 and 2011.25. It's also accepted as a Codex Type 1 method. This procedure is outlined in this slide, where starch is hydrolyzed with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase, 16 hours, 37 degrees centigrade, pH 6. Change of pH, then protein hydrolysis, and eventually measurement of low molecular weight dietary fiber or soluble dietary fiber soluble in ethanol and high molecular weight dietary fiber, which is a combination of insoluble dietary fiber and soluble dietary fiber that precipitates in the presence of 4 volumes of alcohol. Incubations with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase can be formed in a shaking water bath in orbital motion, as shown in this slide. Alternatively, incubations can be performed over a submersible magnetic stirrer, as shown in this slide, in which case up to 15 incubations can be performed at the same time. The problems and challenges in the application of AOAC method 2009.01 to a range of food samples and ingredients is shown in this slide. Firstly, the incubation time is 16 hours. However, the likely time of residence of food in the small intestine is just 3 to 5 hours. Phosphate cross-linked starches, RS4, are underestimated. Resistant maltodextrins are produced from non-resistant starch under the incubation conditions used. Fructooligosaccharides are underestimated using the sugar pack columns. The trisaccharide F3 elutes after sucrose on the HPLC column. Sodium azide preservative is essential with incubation times of 16 hours, but it is undesirable. Sample deionization for HPLC is tedious, and finally, desorbitol is not considered to be the best internal standard. To get some indication of the likely time of residence of food in the small intestine, I referred to literature. And looking at quite a number of papers, the average time of transit appears to be close enough to 4 hours, or 4 plus or minus 1 hour. So we decided to choose 4 hours as the incubation time in these studies. The time course of hydrolysis of a range of starches by pancreatic alpha amylase plus amyloglucosidase, either in tubes shaken in a water bath or in bottles shaken or stirred in bottles, is shown in this slide. We have hyaline 7, a high amylase maize starch, wheat starch, native potato starch, and fiber sim. What is evident is that independent of the method of stirring or shaking, the rates of hydrolysis are very similar. Wheat starch is completely hydrolyzed after 4 hours, consistent with what would be expected on transit time through the small intestine. The differences between AOAC method 2009.01 and the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure are shown in this slide. Basically, the incubation time has been decreased from 16 hours to 4 hours, and hydrolysis is achieved by increasing the pancreatic alpha amylase from 2 to 5 kilounits per assay and a myeloglucosidase from 0.14 to 1.7 kilounits per assay. Otherwise, the other steps are the same. Dietary fiber values obtained for a number of polysaccharides with the rapid integrated dietary fiber procedure are very similar to those obtained with AOAC method 2009.01 and also with AOAC method 991.43, the Lee or Prosky type methods. The one difference is high amylase maize starch, where values of 58.8% are obtained with the rapid integrated procedure and only 29.3% with the Lee procedure. In this slide, we see the recovery of oligosaccharides using the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure and AOAC method 2009.01. For all oligosaccharides except Advanta fiber, which is isomaltooligosaccharides, the recovery of the oligosaccharides is very similar with both methods, even though with the rapid procedure, much higher levels of enzymes are used. This demonstrates the purity of these enzymes, and they are up to the mark for the analysis. The high molecular weight dietary fiber values obtained for a range of samples using AOAC method 2009.01 and the new rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure are very similar. The two exceptions shown here are fiber sim, an RS4 or phosphate crosslink starch, and hyaline 7, an RS2 starch. With the rapid integrated procedure, quite significantly higher values are obtained. This slide shows a comparison of dietary fiber values obtained for a range of starch-containing samples using AOAC method 2009.01 with those obtained with the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure. We can see for all samples analyzed, the high molecular weight dietary fiber value is very similar whichever method was used, except for the samples of FiberSim and Hyaline 7. For these two examples, the values obtained with the rapid procedure are significantly higher than that obtained with AOAC method 2009.01. In AOAC method 2009.01, hydrolysis of non-resistant starch results in the production of small quantities of resistant oligosaccharides, particularly a heptasaccharide, the structure of which has been determined. With the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure, in which higher concentrations of enzymes are used, this heptasaccharide is not formed. Analysis of samples by HPLC requires that the salts are removed by ion exchange chromatography. Traditionally, this has been done by running the sample through a small column containing anion and cation exchange resins. An alternative is to use a de-ashing pre-column before the HPLC columns, such as the TSK gel PWX1 guard column shown in this slide. The problem is that these columns are quite expensive and very rapidly used up. The longevity of the de-ashing pre-column can be increased by removing most of the salt from the sample simply by adding the sample to a tube containing cation and anion exchange resins and mixing the contents for about 5 minutes, then removing the sample for chromatography. In this slide, we see HPLC of a mixture of glycerol and glucose of a sample not desalted, with the buffer salts as present in the normal incubation, then a sample desalted in the tube by just mixing the sample with the resins and shaking up for 5 minutes. You can see most of the salt is removed. And finally, if this sample is run through a de-ashing pre-column, all of the salt is removed. By doing this, we can extend the use of the de-ashing column from around about 20 samples to 150. In comparing the Rapid Integrated Total Dietary Fiber method to AOAC method 2009.01, the incubation time with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase has been reduced from 16 hours to 4 hours by increasing the level of these two enzymes used. Specific maltodextrins that are produced on hydrolysis of non-resistant starch in AOAC method 2009.01 are not produced in the Rapid Integrated TDF method. Higher resistant starch and dietary fiber values are obtained for some phosphate cross-linked starches, particularly FiberSym. Using the TSK gel HPLC column gives complete separation and measurement of fructooligosaccharides. Sodium azide is not required in the incubation buffer because the incubation times have been reduced. Sample preparation for HPLC has been simplified. The enzymes have been reformatted in a powder form and glycerol-free. And finally, glycerol is used as the internal standard. So where are we at present? Currently, an interlaboratory evaluation of the Rapid Integrated Total Dietary Fiber procedure is currently underway under the auspices of AACC International and ICC International, and we plan to involve AOAC International when the data is collected. The method is being adapted to the NCOM fiber analyzer, and we believe the methodology should be available within 2 to 4 weeks. And we are also currently preparing the enzymes in tablet form. Thank you very much.
Let's continue with the presentation, in this case, automation and the applications using the ANCOM system. What we're going to cover in our presentation is, first, we're going to look at the real-world problems with a conventional method. What are some of the things that impact accuracy and precision? Then we're going to talk about the science behind the automation. How did we automate such a difficult method? Then we're going to look at real results, not from a statistical analysis of it, but just to give you a snapshot of comparative results, precision, things like that. And then we'll wrap up with just a connection to what we're doing when it comes to the work that Barry McCleary is doing to create a rapid integrated dietary fiber method. So first, let's talk about the factors that impact accuracy and precision. Certainly, there are human factors. Both education, a person's knowledge of the method and why certain things are done in certain ways, experience levels. At one point, you could say, you know, a person with a great deal of experience is going to get the best results. However, sometimes with experience comes shortcuts and missing some of the finer points, where sometimes a person that's brand new to it is very carefully watching the method and making sure they're doing every element of it. So experience can work both ways when it comes to accuracy and precision. One of the key factors when it comes to accuracy and precision is, quite frankly, what's going on in the laboratory. It's busy out there. Technicians are expected to do a lot more work, accomplish a lot more tasks, and so those demands, those requirements often create shortcuts and missed elements of a methodology. When it comes to supervision, if the supervisors are not knowledgeable in what is required in the method, it's hard to make sure that the technicians are doing every step that they're supposed to do. And quite frankly, we can't be looking over people's shoulders all the time. We have to make sure training is good and that people are following the method. But the bottom line is those human factors can impact accuracy and precision. The method itself, the two of the key developers of the method make the statement that the analysis does require precise handling of the digestion steps. And so if there are shortcuts, if there's modifications made that have not been validated, it's going to have an impact on results. What are some of the things that can impact it? Sample preparation is a rudimentary type of an element, but the bottom line is it can have a pretty significant effect. The homogeneity of the sample, the grind size, the method actually calls out a specific grind size, but lots of times laboratories are just grinding everything the same way, or they're receiving samples that have already been ground. They don't know if they've been ground according to the method. That can affect the results. How the samples are handled, the transfer of the samples from weigh boats to beakers and through filtration, sample storage, all these things can impact it. I was watching a laboratory doing a soxhlet extraction. This is a dramatization of it. And the technician was basically weighing samples into Wattman paper, and as she was taking the Wattman paper and samples to fold them to go into the thimble, she spilled sample on the table. She looked both ways to make sure no one was watching, and then she, with her ungloved hand, wiped sample back into the Wattman paper, saw particles on the desk, blew them off, caused all the other samples to ripple around. And then she proceeded to finish rolling up the sample to go into the thimble. I stepped forward at that point and said, what are you going to do with that? And she looked at me and said, close enough. That is part of the problem we can have with sample handling. Agitation is an important element for it because during the enzyme digestions, you want the sample to have a lot of surface area. You want to have the sample suspended throughout the fluids, the liquids, in order for the enzymes to do their job. The methods themselves have different call-outs for the type of agitation. Some are very specific and tell the revolutions per minute of an agitation. Some just say continuous or periodic agitation. But again, as different labs are doing different things and different types of agitation, it could be a problem. I had one customer that looked at our system and said the agitation itself was justification because they currently could not have agitation of their samples and told their technicians to every 10 minutes or so to swirl the beakers out of the water bath in order to provide that agitation. Well, again, if the sample's not fully suspended in the solution, it's going to impact the results. From a temperature control standpoint, this can be largely sample dependent, but it's also dependent, it's an important factor for the enzyme and the best operating temperature. There's also a pH factor as well for the different enzymes. In the method 991.43, it talks about the amylase digestion, which is the first digestion, being at 95 to 100 degrees for at least 15 minutes of the operation. And I had a laboratory in another country, which mistranslated that. They basically translated it into their language to say that it had to be 95 to 100 degrees for 35 minutes. And that's not what the method says. And so they're going to get an impact on their results. Filtration is probably the most difficult of the issues, or maybe the most problematic of the conventional method, because you have a 60 milliliter Gooch crucible with a diatomaceous earth bed that is placed in order to reduce the porosity of the filter, and you've got 360 or more milliliters of solution at the end that you're trying to filter through that. And as the as gel forms, or if the digested and precipitated liquid is highly viscous, it can have difficulty passing through the filters. And so the filters, what happens is people have to break the gel. The method specifically says to break just the surface of the gel. But as people get frustrated with it and they're spending hours trying to filter in some cases, they start digging into that diatomaceous earth or disrupting it in order to get the flow going, and that's going to have an impact on results. The bottom line is, although each variable may have a small impact, it is cumulative. And so as you continue to add variables and lack of control, you're going to have a problem, and that's going to ultimately affect your results in a significant way. And you'll see that when we talk about precision a little bit later on. So the bottom line is, with all those issues, human factors and then just method factors, we had a problem. How do you automate a method like that? How do you take a method that requires multiple enzyme and chemical additions, multiple temperature requirements, PF or pH modifications. There's transfer and filtration processes that includes rinse steps. And we know that there's filtration difficulties because of the clogging of the gel of highly viscous samples. You have to go from a insoluble dietary fiber step, a series of digestions, to a precipitation step in a 95% ethanol solution, and follow that with another series of filtrations and rinses. How can you automate a method like that? Well, the answer ultimately came through our research in developing what we call a dual chamber filter bag. We looked at a lot of different concepts, a lot of different ways to increase surface area and things like that, but it really came down to the best way was to create this dual chamber filter bag, which allows us to have a polymer material, polymer bag that has a filter on the bottom of it. And so what happens is you have the top act as the beaker, and then you're able to apply mechanical separation points to that so you can separate the digestion, in the case of an insoluble dietary fiber, from the filtration step. And then by computer controls, you can take care of when the solution is transferred from the top to the bottom for filtration. You can handle solution additions. You can handle agitation, all these things mechanically. Likewise, the filters had to match the requirements of the method because we are just automating the method, not creating a new method. So porosity and a recognition of the different surface tension of the solutions was critical to the development of this. We have an aqueous solution for the insoluble dietary fiber digestions. We have a ethanol-based solution for the precipitation. The materials had to be able to address the different surface tensions, the different solutions involved. That was the critical element of our being able to automate. So now I'm going to turn it over to Brian Layton. He's going to go discuss a little bit the actual methodology, the steps involved in both conventional and what the ANCOM does to automate it. And then he'll be looking at some real results relative to precision and accuracy. So Brian, why don't you take it from here?
Thank you. This first slide shows many of the steps, in fact, all of the steps of the conventional method, from cleaning the glassware to finally going through the protein and ash processes. As you can see, there are 38 steps that we show here, which doesn't include the number of times that a technician may go back to try to increase the speed of the of each filtering process. Now, our next slide will show you the difference between, and of course, again, we have all the same steps in the ANCOM automated method, but as we begin to go step by step, you'll see how many of those steps we actually automate so that the technician does not have to perform them. For example, the preparation for the test, all of the glassware is removed. We have just left weighing the filter bags, weighing the samples and DE, and of course putting the bags on the instrument and then placing the sample and DE in the bags. As far as the digestion step is concerned, all of the steps with one exception are gone, simply again because the instrument does everything automatically, and that one step is to check and or adjust the pH. Isolate the IDF portion. Again, the instrument does so many of the steps that we're left with three steps that we actually perform off of the instrument, and that is the acetone rinse and then drying and reweighing the IDF bags. And just the same situation with the isolate of the SDF bags. Again, all of the filtration, all of the rinses are performed by the instrument, so we have those three follow-on positions that we'll do as we did with the IDF bags. And finally, we do have the protein and ash to work through, and then of course to calculate the results using the weights and corrections. So you can see that we have eliminated so many of the steps, which moves us to our next slide, and where we can see what kind of time savings that the automated system will provide. Now, we know that the instrument itself and the time it takes to go through the technique is according to method. So the actual testing time is very consistent with the method. But when we consider time savings here, much of that time saving is in the filtration. Many have reported to us hours and hours of filtration time just for one sample, or
for the conventional method.
For the conventional method, yes. However, we have found that an average time for filtration with the automated system is 5 to 10 minutes, and some of the longer times we've seen are 15 or 20 minutes. So that it really does save an awful lot of time in regard to filtration. And of course, if the filtration is not occurring and we don't have the scraping of the DE, for example, during the filtration, then the technician's time is eased. And of course, all of those steps we saw in the previous slide adds to additional time that the technician can place somewhere else in the lab. And of course, when we reduce time that the technician is involved, we also reduce cost per assay, which is extremely important. Our next slide will show some of the reproducibility of our system. The top three samples, the cereal, the carrots, and the onions, are samples that we run constantly in our lab as check samples. And you can see the standard deviations for both IDF and SDF. And I would suggest, as we have done a number of samples through the years, those are quite normal standard deviations. It's difficult to get really good comparisons with labs that are doing the conventional work simply because they don't want to run that many copies of the samples, but the standard deviations found through our system are pretty standard, as you can see right here. Our next slide will show some results from the AACC check sample program. There are about 30 different labs that report every month, and you can see it goes from 2012 right up through 2015. Now the white portions of the chart are the range of reports. So in some cases we have 7, 8, 9, 10% differences for those labs reporting values. The red dots that you see were our reporting values, and the blue lines show the average of all those labs that we're reporting. In some cases, we're maybe a bit high, a little bit low, but in most cases, we're right at about the average of the labs that we're reporting. The key here is that the difference between all of those labs, in some cases, can be very great, simply because of the variation that Chris talked about earlier in the session.
And that's what's kind of critical about this slide, as I look at it, is just recognizing the inter-lab imprecision that there is. And that's pretty common. I've actually had people that have approached us at exhibitions and things like that, and they would identify a specific lab. They'll only send it to one lab because the other labs always give them bad results. You know, that's their view of it. So anytime you start seeing really strong ranges like this, you know, 8, 9 points, as Brian pointed out, you've got a problem. With ours, again, if you think of the slide that Brian showed before, with our highest standard deviation was a 0.38, that's what we're getting when we run these samples numerous times. So those red dots represent the number that we consistently get. And as Brian said, it's normally at the average of all the other, again, 23 or so labs that participate.
And this slide shows a bit of a comparative between samples that we've had that we have run in our lab and that were run through the conventional method. Our next slide, and we'll go to that one, I want to show you specifically down toward the bottom of this one, the corn brands that were run here. Specifically, the last corn brand, you notice actually that that's the greatest difference between the result gained from the automated TDF instrument and the manual method. What we found was that we called the group that had this particular sample, and they had sent the sample to a lab that we respect very much. So we were a little bit concerned at the variation that showed here. However, when we contacted the lab, they indicated, as you can see at the bottom of the chart, that they were very concerned that they had a problem when testing the sample and weren't real confident with the reported values. One thing I would like to point out about this slide and the previous slide too, you'll notice that there's really quite a range of values when you look at, for example, the top one, the mini Mexican at 2.1 or 1.3 in our case. And in fact, in the previous slide, the shrimp, for example, at 0.7 or 0.5. And then you go all the way to the next slide where we're getting into the 85 percentile. So there's quite a range of percentage, of quite a range certainly of samples that the instrument will pick up. And we have had samples that were extremely low, like that shrimp, and we've had samples that were even higher than these samples that show here. So I think that's a very important case also. A lot of people ask us what type of range will your instrument pick up.
And Brian, you have done one thing that we don't have on these slides that I think is an important one to bring out, is there are some samples that in the conventional, using a fritted glass crucible, they just can't do. They cannot, it won't filter. Psyllium husk is a good example.
Correct.
And I know that psyllium husk we have done total dietary fiber analysis on, which is basically digesting the upper portion and then going directly, the filtrate going directly into a precipitation phase. And we have done that with psyllium husk and got excellent results, excellent precision. But that's an example, thinking back to our filtration, that's an example of one that took us, I believe, 20 minutes to filter.
Yeah, that does take a little bit longer, but yeah, 20 minutes is a pretty good average on that sample.
Right. Yeah, that's a sample that the conventional method, they can't do. Normally, they'll use a centrifuge in order to eliminate the filtration issue because they just can't do it.
Correct. Yeah. Correct.
Good. Well, let me close our presentation with just kind of a summary. I hope we didn't miss too many key points from you. Of course, questions are coming in on the chat box, which we appreciate, and we're going to address those. But just to close this portion of it, and then we'll go to our questions and answers. The system that we developed automates, as the base system, the standard system, if you will, automates 991.43 and 985.29. We have the capability, there's an upgrade, it's not a huge increase in price, but you can at any time upgrade to the codex definition methods, which in our case are AOAC 2009-01 and AOAC 2011.25. As Barry continues his work on the rapid integrated dietary fiber method, if that gets approved, we will be looking at some modifications in order to support that method as well. For those people that already have our system, there'll probably be an upgrade opportunity. When it comes to cost, it's really going to depend on if we have to go to a whole new controller or if we're able to make it all work with our current controller. So that's yet to be determined, but our goal is to make sure we're able to support the major methods that are being used for dietary fiber analysis. The system does do, you can measure independently the insoluble dietary fiber, the IDF, the soluble dietary fiber, SDF, as well as a total. Whether you're combining the IDF and SDF or just running a total dietary fiber, our system can do that. As we showed before, we're seeing reductions in labor and technician time as much as 75%, which obviously reduces your cost per assay. There's no need for water baths. There's no need for filtration flasks. There's no need for Gooch crucibles. The bottom line is we're going to save you a lot of counter space when it comes down to that. So why don't we stop here now, and we will look at some of these questions, and if necessary, we can actually turn on microphones so you can speak to us. But let's start by looking at the chat line questions and see what we can address there.